Breaking news from around your world on this Friday, June 14th, 2019. I'm Larry Rice. The United States government is blaming Iran for attacks on two oil tankers near the Persian Gulf, casting it as the latest in a series of provocative actions that have sharply raised tensions in the region. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo said Thursday that the U.S. assessment of Iran's responsibility for the attacks, which forced the evacuation of the crews in international waters, was based in part on intelligence as well as on the expertise needed to carry out the operation. Pompeo also said it was based on a recent series of incidents in the region that the U.S. blames on Iran, including a similar attack on tankers in the area in May and the bombing of an oil pipeline in Saudi Arabia by Iranian-backed fighters. The U.S. planned to raise the attacks at the U.N. Security Council. Pompeo also said the U.S. would defend its forces and interests in the Middle East, but gave no details on any immediate plans. Tensions between Iran and the U.S. have been growing since President Donald Trump last year withdrew from an international agreement aimed at restricting Iran's nuclear program and reinstated economic sanctions that have had a devastating effect on the Iranian economy. In May, the U.S. rushed an aircraft carrier strike group and other military assets to the Persian Gulf region in response to what it said were threats from Iran. The man accused of shooting worshippers at two New Zealand mosques pleaded not guilty Thursday to all 92 charges. Appearing in the High Court at Christchurch via video link from Auckland Prison, Australian citizen Brenton Tarrant, who is 28, sat motionless as his lawyers entered his not guilty pleas to 51 charges of murder, 40 charges of attempted murder, and one charge under the Terrorism Suppression Act. Tarrant is accused of entering two mosques in the city of Christchurch on March 15th and opening fire with military-grade weapons on worshippers, killing 51. Prior to the plea being entered, Justice Cameron Mander said the court had received Tarrant's mental health assessments that showed he was fit to stand trial. Mander says he expects the trial to last 6 weeks and initially set the trial to start in February 2020. But Shane Tate of the defense counsel said he believed it would last 3 months and that more time would be needed to prepare their case. Mander then amended the start of the trial to May 4th of 2020. Actor Cuba Gooding Jr. turned himself in and was arrested Thursday on charges he groped a woman in an encounter at a New York City night spot that appears to have been caught on video. The 51-year-old Oscar-winning star of Jerry Maguire denies the allegations and entered a plea of not guilty to forcibly touching and sexual abuse charges at a night court arraignment. He was released on his own recognizance after about 6 hours in police custody. A 29-year-old woman told police that Gooding placed his hand on her breast and squeezed it without her consent Sunday night at Magic Hour Rooftop Bar and Lounge. The woman said she believed Gooding was intoxicated. Video obtained by TMZ that the website says is from inside the bar on the night in question appears to show Gooding putting his hand on or near a woman's leg and breast as they sit on a couch with another woman between them. The video could be key evidence for prosecutors, but Gooding's lawyer said the footage showed not the slightest scintilla of inappropriate conduct and will exonerate him. Central American migrants, eager to beat a crackdown by Mexico on its southern border with Guatemala, scrambled into the country Thursday as the Mexican government prepared to send thousands of National Guard members to plug gaps in the porous southern frontier. Mexico had agreed with the United States to demonstrate by late July that it can contain a surge in U.S.-bound migrants, following a threat from President Trump to impose tariffs on Mexican goods if it failed to do so. Foreign Minister Marcelo Ebrard said this week that Mexico would beef up control of its southern border, including sending 6,000 members of the National Guard. The deployment was due to begin on Wednesday, though witnesses saw no signs of the deployment. Mexico sends around 80% of its exports to the U.S., so any move by Trump to impose levies on its goods would have serious repercussions for the economy, which is already struggling after contracting in the first quarter. New York State eliminated the religious exemption to vaccine requirements for school children Thursday, as the nation's worst measles outbreak in decades prompts many states to reconsider giving parents ways to opt out of immunization rules. The Democrat-led Senate and Assembly voted Thursday to repeal the exemption, which allows parents to cite religious beliefs to forego getting their child the vaccines required for school enrollment. Governor Andrew Cuomo, a Democrat, signed the measure minutes after the final vote. The law takes effect immediately, but will give unvaccinated students up to 30 days after they enter a school to show they've had the first dose of each required immunization. With New York's move, similar exemptions are still allowed in 45 states, though lawmakers in several of them have introduced their own legislation to eliminate the waiver. The debate has only intensified with this year's measles outbreak, which federal officials recently said has surpassed 1,000 illnesses, the highest in 27 years. The Brazilian Supreme Court ruled Thursday that homophobia should be criminalized under existing legislation until Congress creates a specific law for the subject, weighing in on a topic that has drawn the ire of President Jair Bolsonaro. 8 of 11 justices voted to treat homophobia in the same way as racism under Brazilian law, making it a criminal act. During the court's deliberations last month, as it became clear that most justices would rule in favor of criminalizing homophobia, Bolsonaro strongly criticized the court. He accused the justices of legislating from the bench and suggested it was time to appoint an evangelical Christian to the Supreme Court. Evangelicals and other socially conservative Brazilians helped Bolsonaro win last year's election as he promised to overturn years of liberal social policies, including more rights for same-sex couples. Bolsonaro, a Catholic who was baptized by an evangelical pastor on a trip to Israel 3 years ago, had a history of making homophobic, racist, and sexist public remarks before he took office January 1st. He told one interviewer he would rather have a dead son than a gay son. Women across Switzerland are preparing for a nationwide strike in protest against what they say is that country's unacceptably slow pace to equality. Friday's protest comes 28 years after similar action saw 500,000 women take to the streets in 1991. Swiss women have long campaigned to accelerate the pace of gender equality. They joined millions of other women in Europe after World War I ended in 1918 in demanding the right to vote, but did not get it until 1971. At the time of the 1991 strike, there were no women in the Swiss government, and there was no statutory maternity leave. Appenzell, the last Swiss canton to refuse women the right to vote, had just been ordered to change its policy by Switzerland's Supreme Court. Some things have changed. There have since been 8 female government ministers, and the right to maternity leave is now enshrined in law. However, women in Switzerland still earn, on average, 20% less than men. They are underrepresented in management positions, and childcare remains not only expensive, but in short supply. Thousands of women have already informed their bosses they won't be at work Friday. Sarah Sanders is leaving her post as White House press secretary at the end of June. Sanders told reporters Thursday that she had informed President Trump earlier in the day of her decision to step down. Trump said she's returning to Arkansas to join the private sector, but there is some speculation she may seek to become the next governor of Arkansas. Her father is former Arkansas Governor Mike Huckabee, a 2-time GOP presidential candidate. The 36-year-old Sanders managed her dad's second White House bid. Asa Hutchinson, the current Arkansas governor, was reelected in 2018 and is limited to 2 terms. The governor's seat in Little Rock will become open in 2022. Word of who may replace Sanders as press secretary was not immediately revealed by the White House. She said she saw no reason to delay informing the president once she had made her decision, saying her departure should give Trump time to put someone else in place before the 2020 presidential campaign heats up. The Toronto Raptors are celebrating Canada's first NBA championship. The Raptors captured the country's first major title in 26 years with their most remarkable road win yet in the franchise's NBA Finals debut, outlasting the battered and depleted two-time defending champ Golden State Warriors 114-110 Thursday night in a Game 6 for the ages. A Canadian team, and we're not talking hockey here, stood on top of one of the traditional major sport leagues for the first time since the Toronto Blue Jays won the 1993 World Series. Fans poured into the streets in Toronto, screaming and honking horns after the Raptors pulled off a third straight win on Golden State's home floor that said goodbye to NBA basketball after 47 seasons. Golden State was already down two-time reigning NBA Finals MVP Kevin Durant, who had surgery Wednesday for a ruptured right Achilles tendon. Then the Warriors lost Klay Thompson to an ACL tear, and they couldn't overcome just one more heartbreaking injury. The Raptors, in their 24th season of existence, rallied from two games down to beat the Bucks in the Eastern Conference Finals and then took down the mighty Warriors on their home floor to deny Golden State a three-peat championship. And that's your update for this Friday, June 14th, 2019. I'm Larry Rice. Thanks so much for listening, and I hope you have a wonderful weekend.